Fuck it, we'll do it live.
What up, my uncle? We'll do it live! Fucking thing sucks!
It's O'Reilly. That's a great clip.
Is it? I'm in Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. I'm from Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. Okay. I'm in Toronto, where you wanna get the city love. My city love me back.
Welcome to episode 1497 of Toronto Mic'd, proudly brought to you by Great Lakes Brewery, a fiercely independent craft brewery who believes in supporting communities, good times, and brewing amazing beer. Order online for free local home delivery in the GTA. Palma Pasta. Enjoy the taste of fresh, homemade Italian pasta and entrees from Palma Pasta in Mississauga and Oakville. The Toronto Maple Leafs baseball team, the best baseball in the city, outside the dome. Join me on June 2nd, 2 p.m. I'm throwing out the first pitch. Yes, that's happening this Sunday. Be there. Recyclemyelectronics.ca. Committing to our planet's future means properly recycling our electronics of the past. Season 6 of Yes, We Are Open, an award-winning Moneris podcast hosted by FOTM Al Grego and Ridley Funeral Home, pillars of the community since 1927.
Something subversive about you and me, 'cause there's a market value on love. We're getting something for free. I don't know why, but when we're apart, something makes me wanna start setting fires and kicking down doors. I hope we never have to resort to dividing what is mine.
Returning to Toronto Mic'd.
There's something coercive.
To kick out the jams with me, it's Simon Head. Welcome back, Simon.
I'm so stoked to be here. I drove across town. I picked up some stuff. I brought presents, my own presents for you.
Okay, because I'm going to give you a whole whack of stuff for making that long trek here. I know that's a pain in the ass when people have to get across the city to visit me, but then I make it worthwhile. I give you a lot of swag.
I love that.
And you've got stuff for me, which I love, actually. But I'm playing this song on purpose because today's the big day, right? Today is the day that Subversives, the history of Lowest of the Low, is available. Like, you can buy it today on DVD? What's going on?
Yeah, it's on Blu-ray and it's available. I did find out that it is on Sunrise at Sunrise Records. You can pick it up coast to coast. Wherever.
Okay, because Cloverdale Mall has a Sunrise Records and the manager is a great FOTM named Robert Lawson, who's going to be on the mic on Sunday when I'm recording live from Christie Pitts during the Toronto Maple Leafs baseball team. Baseball game. The team is playing a game.
They're playing a game. Yeah. So I found that out. I did a lot of my own research to find out where it's coming out and how it's coming out. And truthfully, the whole thing about a Blu-ray for me was like, well, who has Blu-rays? Who needs Blu-rays? And what I found is people our age have kids with PlayStations, and they have Blu-rays in them. So you can watch it. If you can pull the controller away from your kid for 3 minutes or an hour and 51 minutes, you can watch the movie on there.
Also, now, you know, the age range of people I see at Lowest of the Low shows, it's vast. You know, the kids are there, the grandparents are there, but I'd say the core are guys like you and I, Gen Xers, and I feel like a good percentage of Gen Xers are still watching DVDs. Am I out to lunch on that?
No, I think you're right. I truly believe that people want something to hold in their hand. That's why vinyl is so important, and now CDs eventually, and cassettes, and things that just so you can viscerally hold on to. I did make a book.
Tangible.
I printed a book too of the movie to sort of in lieu of a Blu-ray. And that went really well, actually. People were really stoked about that. But then this whole thing about the Blu-ray thing just came up, and I was stoked.
Okay, so this is Blu-ray available now, and you can go to Sunrise Records, and there's sunrises across this fine country. You don't have to go to Cloverdale Mall, but if you do, ask to speak to Robert Lawson and say,
I'm here to buy Subversives, The History of the Lowest of the Low, because I heard about it on Toronto Mic'd. Let Robert Lawson know it. He'll get a kick out of that. And he's the official fact checker of the Toronto Mic'd podcast. Simon, we last saw each other at the concert hall.
That's right. Yeah. The Lowest of the Low show.
And it was good. So tell the people, what is your day job? So, I mean, you directed this documentary, which I've seen and quite enjoyed, and we'll kick out the jams and we'll kind of talk about things between songs. But what's your day job?
I'm a production coordinator at Exhibition Place. I deal with large and small events throughout Exhibition. The space, I deal with the C&E. I deal with all the tenants. So Queen Elizabeth Theatre, Liberty Grand, Toronto Event Centre. I deal with a lot of things, all things crew. So if it's a production, I help them bring in the right amount of crew and make sure that they have the right amount of unionized help.
Do you have anything to do with the upcoming Toronto Festival of Beer?
I do not.
Okay, because that's at the Grandstand. I just wondered if that would fall into your somehow.
Yeah, I did the EV autonomy charging expo, and then I do sort of, I'm supposed to be doing more of tenant stuff, so I do like smaller things. Right. I did the motorcycle show, things like that. But it's, to me, it's like, yeah, it's a very small facet of what I've done in the past, but it's also kind of rewarding, and it's a real
job. Cool.
Yeah, it's a real job.
So what do you do for what would you say you do for Lowest of the Low?
I'm the chief cat herder. I deal with, I'm their tour manager, front house sound.
Wow.
Recently, I just sort of helped them out with booking some hotels and did some routing through their Iron Roses tour in the eastern part of the United States. And I'm sort of their guy. I feel like them. I hold the flag and I plant it firmly, and I let people know about this great band.
You're the unofficial fifth member of this band. Did I do the math right?
Hold on. I think you did. No, wait. Sixth member.
Is it sixth member? Right. Yeah. I lose track here. Only two ever come over. I've noted. I'm starting to take it personally. Like, there's only two members of Lowest of the Low that will come over, and they're both sweethearts. I should shout out Ron Hawkins and Lawrence Nichols, who both come over all the time, and you come over, and that's great, and I've got to know you, and I love your documentary here on the Lowest of the Low. People should check it out. We'll talk more about it, but I got a few notes when you were coming on, but one from Manfred from Elephants and Stars, and he was just saying, tune in tomorrow to hear musician, producer, documentarian extraordinaire and Elephants and Stars keys slinger Simon Head play some tunes, and I imagine tell some cool stories in between. So what is this keys slinger thing you've done?
To figure out what a key slinger is.
Like, have you done anything for Elephants and Stars?
Yeah, I'm their sort of stand-in keyboard player, so whenever there's
a show. Okay, well, that's a key slinger. You're like the Rob Proust of Elephants and Stars.
Is that a slinger, though? Do you really sling keys? I don't know. Like some sleight of, I don't know. I've played with them. Like, it's so funny. I never knew Manfred in the day, because Manfred's been around forever, and so have I. And we just met each other on Facebook, and I was sort of just transitioning with work, and a band I was in was sort of falling apart. And so I was like, put my name out there. And then I found out that there was a keyboard position opening, and it's a really rewarding thing to sort of go into something where I'm actually not fully in charge. I can actually just play music. And I kind of went out of my way, Manfred, I'm letting the secret out, to try not to learn the chords. So I kind of jam on that, and when we record it, which I actually have 13 songs to record this week, they're in the middle of finishing off a record with Ian Blurton, which is
love that guy.
Phenomenal.
Shout out to Ian Blurton,
absolutely, and it's a phenomenal sounding record. I'm very impressed.
Well, if Ian's involved and you're involved and Manfred's involved, it's got to be decent, right?
It'll be good.
Okay, so I told myself a long time ago, Mike, get to the jams quicker, and we can talk in between the jams. So we're going to rock and roll here. We're going to kick out 10 of your favorite songs of all time. We're going to talk about it. I have more Lowest of the Low questions. I have more questions about Subversives. I have gifts for you. I understand you might have gifts for me. That makes me very excited. But I have one quick question before we go. Simon Head. And there's only one H in Head, right?
Yeah, that's right. Though I do have a Head affiliation, actually.
Well, tell me, because Noah Mintz is an FOTM. And then, of course, I'm going to see Hayden on Wednesday night. And he was buddies with Noah in high school, I believe. And they were in a band together. But what is your affiliation with Head?
I produced their first cassette, that Before Fireman.
Is Happy on that?
I don't know.
Okay, because you don't know. Okay, so before Fire, okay, cause I think okay, Happy won them the New Music Search 1993 CFNY New Music Search contest that Lowest of the Low thought they were going to win.
Yes, there was. Yeah, there's a story there. Yeah, no, I produced their first cassette. I think it was like a 4 or 5 song EP on cassette, and
amazing.
Yeah, yeah.
And now Noah's like a mastering master.
Lacquer Channel.
There, yes,
that's he's a mastering slinger.
He's a slinger of the masters.
Of the masters.
So my one question for you is this, Simon. Are you ready to kick out the jams?
I am. It's a great song.
You better think it's a great song because you chose it.
My favorite song. Chords don't make sense in this. Like that part. So rad. It's either this one or Up the Junction.
All right, talk to me here. What song are we listening to? Why did you choose it? And I do love the fact you're a musician and can tell me things about, you know, things that don't make sense because... let's get to the chorus here. Why pulling muscles from a shell?
I remember being like 8 years old and had 1050 Chum, the AM radio station that played hits in the day, and listening to this song for the first time. And it was songs that like, it was post-punk, you know what I mean? Or it was like just at the end of punk rock and where things were still a bit edgy. There wasn't a full keyboard takeover. And it's just this song. It's so good. Like, It's sort of, like I said, there's some chords in there that shouldn't really go together.
It just came together and it worked.
Yeah.
It just worked. Pulling Muscles from a Shell, Squeeze, of course, the band here. And I'm just, now I'm trying to think. So 1050 Chum was like top 40 until I think like 86 or something. And then they went to like Golden Oldies or some kind of greatest hits type deal.
Yeah.
But that, so was that your first favorite station? Like, give me an idea of what your first favorite station would be.
Yeah, I remember being in camp and I had a transistor radio and I would listen to only had AM on it. And I was dreaming of having a cassette recorder so I could record shows.
Sure.
But I had this little transistor radio, didn't even have an earpiece. It was just this thing I took to camp with me. And I would listen to songs like this and like Switch to Glide by the Kings, like all that type of music.
And that song shouts out Toronto.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. There were so many great, like, I don't know. It's just so, I don't know. The thing about Squeeze, what I learned later on is like three amazing songwriters, like three individual great songwriters that all had different types of music. It shouldn't have worked, right? And maybe today's world, it won't. It wouldn't.
Here's some keys. Well, Sloan does it.
That's true. Yes, they do, but they haven't put a record out in a while. I'm just saying. Neither is Squeeze.
Yeah, that's a good point there. Let me think of that on that for a moment. Like, active bands with, like, three people who can sing lead. I'll have to noodle that one, because Sloan jumped in my head, but you're right, they haven't put out any new music in a while. Oh, yeah, well, now we can say Trans-Canada Highwaymen do that, but they don't put out their own original music.
No, they don't.
They do covers and their own music.
Yeah. Well, we'll have to think, because I know there's obviously people have their own bands and then they collaborate and then they write songs and that becomes sort of like a super group.
Sure. Chris Murphy's in 10 of them.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Except for Traveling Wilburys. He's not in that. Not yet.
You know, we kicked out so yesterday, and I'll shout out Yes, We Are Open. That's an award-winning podcast from Moneris that you should subscribe to. In fact, let me give you your first of many gifts today, Simon. That's a wireless speaker from Moneris, so you can listen to Yes, We Are Open.
Sweet.
Hosted by Al Grego, who was here yesterday, kicking out jams that are related to episodes from season 6. And one of the songs we kicked out was Handle With Care by Traveling Wilburys.
That's a classic, too.
And we were trying to think of the equivalent, like the Canadian equivalent. Is there a Canadian equivalent to the Traveling Wilburys?
Trans-Canada Highwaymen.
But they don't write their own music.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
See, that's the difference.
Let's see.
They should, though.
They should. Like, well, maybe we'll try to get it together. We get like an Ian Hunter to get together with a Murray McLaughlin to get together with
You mean Ian Blurton?
Ian Blurton.
Because Ian Hunter's not Canadian.
Isn't he not? Okay, then. Ian Blurton.
He's from Cleveland, I think.
With John Kastner.
Yeah.
And
from Doughboys.
With Doughboys, and we'll put
Scotty Mac in there. Yeah.
Yeah, Scott McCullough playing guitar. Kastner, who's going to play bass?
I love this game.
Yeah, yeah, our super group.
And they got to write their own music.
They do have to. And this is like similar to the Traveling Wilburys.
All right, so you got your speaker. I'm rolling into your second jam because it's kind of tight. You talked about post-punk and this kind of cool vibe scene going on here. I think this fits right in. Let's get to your second jam.
Oh, my baby.
Oh, this has got the greatest intro.
I love you more than I can tell. I don't think I can live without you. And I know that I never will.
That's a real tape hiss there, too.
Yeah.
Oh, my baby, baby. I want you so it scares me to death. I can't say any more than I love you. Everything else is a waste of breath.
Hear that false ending?
Hey.
I want you. You had your fun, you don't get well no more. I want you. Your fingernails go dragging down the wall. Be careful, darling, you might fall. I want you.
Yeah.
I woke up in
there's no chorus in this song.
It just goes.
Just this
nowhere,
riff.
Nowhere to fade down then. Okay, yeah. Tell me about your admiration for the real Elvis, Elvis Costello.
It's so funny. I was talking to somebody the other day about Elvis Costello, and I realized that I'm a Elvis Costello snob. So I'm Armed Forces, My Aim Is True. Everything else is good, but this song, it hit me once I was on tour in the early 2000s, and I just about to get married, and I missed my wife so much that I had this, and I actually played this song over my phone, my Nokia 5130 or whatever the hell it was, to my wife. And I'm like, this is the song I'm feeling right now, and put it on her answering machine.
Wow. Yeah, that's romantic.
Yeah, and it's just this great. And I think I think he just makes up words at the end. I think he just...
Well, you're like the conductor. You can tell me to bring it up in the mix here.
Yeah.
Absolutely. But love it. I want you, Elvis Costello.
Yeah. And I'll say that by saying I'm still trying to read and finish the his biography. And I just can't get through it because that's what I realized. Like, I think I only like two real... Mighty Like a Rose is good. Like, they're all good, but it's so vast, right?
Yeah. Interesting. And he married a Canadian.
He did.
There you go. So he's a Canadian adjacent. We can put him in our super group, maybe.
Maybe not.
He married him. He gets it through marriage. Okay. Excellent. On the live stream at live.torontomike.com, Jeremy Hopkin, the official historian of the Toronto Mike podcast, says he loves owning physical media, so he's not held hostage by streaming services. Now, this begs the question, for those of us who, you know, want to stream Subversives, where can we stream Subversives?
You can get it on Apple TV presently in Canada and the United States. This button. You know he's just making that shit up. There you go. Okay.
It sounds like a dude just like, some four-track player or whatever, recording himself with a guitar.
Yeah,
like,
I have an idea.
Amazing.
Count me in. I don't know where they're going. Okay, just count me in. shout out Dewey Cox, Walk Hard.
That's right. John C. Reilly.
Yeah, you can watch it on Apple TV. If you don't have Apple TV, you don't need Apple TV. It's online, Apple TV dot whatever it is, whatever your country is. Out in Australia.
I don't think we're being heard outside of Canada. No, I'm just kidding.
How dare you?
I might have an expat or two out there.
Yeah, yeah. So I think Ireland's coming, but every time I talk with the people who are in charge of it, I said, it costs money every time we do this, right? He goes, yes, it does. I'm like, okay, well, let's not put it in like Lithuania or somewhere.
Well, you might be big there. They're big deadheads in Lithuania, right? Didn't the Grateful Dead buy them their basketball jersey or uniforms or something?
I have no idea, but that's a great...
And Bill Walton died yesterday. He was a big deadhead, and as he's a... NBA All Star. He's in the Hall of Fame. The guy was an amazing basketball player, but he was like famous for being like an early Deadhead amongst like the most famous of the Deadheads. Have you ever, gone to a jam band in college?
No, I never got the Dead, but there was a guy that I knew in Thunder Bay who owned a record label called Meathead Records. His name's Eric, and he put all these like Head Cramp records out, and these compilations.
Right.
And his roommate was a full-on Deadhead. So it was like it was like fire and water, like living together, because he would do cassette trading, and he had a whole wall of cassettes from live shows, because that's a big Deadhead thing.
Yeah, listen, on Sunday I had Rob Pruse over here with Bob Ouellette, and we do this every month. It's called Toast, and we kicked out our favorite jams. So I kind of had to go in just for a couple of weeks. I was living in this world, and I realized, oh, it's really not for me. Like,
it's not my thing. Yeah,
it's not my thing.
I think you got to be there, and I think you got to be high. If you're not there either or,
100%,
you got to sort of somehow vibe it.
No, you got to be. I think you need to consume some cannabis to appreciate it. But shout out to Canada Kev, who is a huge Deadhead himself. Absolutely.
I don't slight anybody who likes the Grateful Dead.
No,
but we had a song. I played in a band called the Fairmounts. We had a song called Deadheads, and it kind of disparaging conversation about who the Deadhead like it is. So I apologize on behalf of the Fairmounts. And
you know, whatever floats your boat, right?
Yeah,
like,
right.
You know, when exactly did the Lowest of the Low become a ska band? Like, did that happen? Because I noticed this and I saw them. I've been seeing them forever, but it's very ska now. Like, obviously they still play Shakespeare My Butt and all that stuff, but you could tell Ron is really into ska lately.
There's an interesting thing about that, because a couple of albums ago, I remember Ron telling me a story, like, we just play old ska songs at rehearsal, and Lawrence kind of sticks his nose up in the air, like, bleh. But then and Greg Smith, I believe, is a huge ska fan, and they all sort of just started doing it, and I think that's how they became a ska band. But I mean, Cheer Up Charlie, what a great song.
Well, you know, the ska sounds great live, and it mixes in nice with all the other stuff. Like, I'm a big fan, as you know. Love it, but it is interesting how, like, it just feels like there was a change at some point, like in the last 5 years, where they went hard on more
ska. I think then there's a new direction coming. I think there's a new record being recorded presently.
Norwegian death metal.
I hope so. Next, one can hope. Someone's got to die.
Is this Ron's Norwegian death metal phase?
I'm not saying yes, but I'm not saying no.
I need to know what's going on. Maybe they're going to embrace like 80s hair metal or something.
I don't think they'll go that far. But I think they will definitely, like, the music is very, that they do is always, like, I think Steve Kane put it in the documentary, said, like, they never did the same thing twice. And that's sort of like it's a thing that's a very, very important thing to say, is that you don't just rest on your laurels, and you just sort of keep pushing forward.
100%. And, you know, they have this punk ethos to them, right? So it's, they always abide there. And shout out to Elliot Lefko, who hopefully is listening, because he tells me he does listen to Toronto Mic'd episodes to remember home. I cannot get Elliot Lefko on Toronto Mic, but you got Elliot Lefko for your documentary. So you beat me that time.
I got another Simon. Elliot thing too, affiliation. We're working together on something else too.
Any clues?
Well, it's about a musician. And it's not actually in my wheelhouse of musical.
I know who it is. I won't. So wink at me. So just give me a sign. Like, you don't want me to spoil it, because I think I know exactly who you're talking about.
Yeah, I don't want to.
Okay, I won't say it then.
Yeah, yeah. I'll tell you off cam.
Because I know. Possibly, is it an FOTM?
No.
Not an FOTM. Okay,
no.
Then I don't actually know.
No, he's a musician. He's living in New York right now. We flew down there to do an interview, 3 hours of interview, and then flew home.
Is this a Canadian?
No, his mother's Canadian.
Okay, then I actually don't know who we're talking about. So if I guess it correctly, it was just a guess.
Yeah. Who were you going to guess?
I was going to guess husband of Amy Sky.
Oh, that was starting that. And
what is his name?
Mark Jordan.
I knew that.
Who was that guy?
Living in Marina Del Rey.
Yeah. It turned out great, but then there's a book thing happening. So for me,
I can't keep up with you, Simon.
I was sort of, well, he was doing a book with another, and I spoke with him and the author, and it turned into like, well, we're doing this and we haven't, it just got complicated. So I was like, you know what? Let's just put that on the back burner.
Do what Martin Scorsese did with the SCTV documentary. Yeah. Just shelve it and work on something else.
They say, the industry, they say, we'll put a pin in it. That's right. Is that what they say?
Which is the nicest way of saying, we're fucking moving on. Right? Let's put a pin in that. Okay, so Mark Jordan not getting
I wish.
The List of the Load treatment, but somebody in New York whose mother is Canadian. Can you give me one more clue, and then I'm going to kick out your next jam, and then I'm going to give you more gifts.
He has been known to jam with people like Jimi Hendrix. He's jammed with people like Brian Jones, Keith Richards. He's a very we might have to just spoil it, but we've started it. We've started.
But is there a reason you wouldn't want to spoil it? Like, why wouldn't you want to wet people's appetite?
If it falls
kind of
apart,
excited?
Like, then it
but
sucks.
But Mark Jordan fell apart, and we just talked true. About it.
We could say he did a whole record of Tom Waits covers.
Okay, that's a very good clue.
Yeah.
I'm going to figure this
out.
You're
going to look online?
And I will say, I just said nobody's listening, but I really quick, and I'm not going to go into details right now, except that I recorded an episode a couple of weeks ago, and I put something in the episode. And literally an hour after it went live, I realized from several very serious and good sources that I made a huge mistake. And I had to go back and beep out a whole bunch of stuff. And I will just say this, and this is the teaser. At some point, I'll tell the story. Probably when Peter Gross drops by, wink, wink. But somebody who was on that episode was called before a judge yesterday morning. And possibly the two of us were facing, ready for this? 6 months in jail and a $25,000 fine.
Ouch.
Let's kick it another jam. Woo.
Oh, this song. I forgot about this song. All of my songs have long intros.
Just like Rosie and Gray.
That's right.
So we can talk it up. You want to hit the post?
You're listening to Trauma Mike Live. This is a good one back from 2001. This is the new year. DJs do it right. They have to like...
But they cheat. Right?
And then you go, oh, yeah. You're listening to on Trauma Mike Live. Oh, shit. I screwed it up.
Oh, yeah. I have seen many a DJ in the last 25 years. They now cheat. There's literally a timer to say, here's the first post, here's the second post, and they're watching the timer. I could hit the post with a fucking timer. So this is the new year. I don't feel any different. Explosions off in the distance. Death Cab for Cutie.
Oh, yeah.
Shout out to Ridley Funeral Home.
Yay, good. So this... I actually knew Death Cab before this album, Transatlanticism, and the photo album. And I heard this song. I was in Europe. It was the first time I was ever in Europe playing with my band Foursquare. And we had this record. It was sort of a pre-release. Hadn't been put out in Europe yet. And we were driving on our way to Holland to play a show with the Weakerthans.
Amazing.
And it was like, I heard this song and I tingled all over. I couldn't. This part right here. So everybody put your best suit or dress on. Let's make believe that we are wealthy for I'm tingling just now. This one. Lighting firecrackers off on the front lawn as 30 dialogues bleed into one. Yeah, so... I wish the world was flat like the old days. Flat like the old days. I just... This song, it reminds me of that first time I toured in Europe. And then when I was touring in Europe, it wasn't my first tour, that it felt like a first tour again, where we're all like in the van listening to this song.
Okay, this is Foursquare, because we never really haven't really dove into your whole like musician life here, but like Foursquare was your band, and you're what, touring with the Weakerthans?
Yeah. So the story with the Weakerthans is that I used to play in a band with Jason Tate. We were called Red Fisher out of Winnipeg. And then I moved back home to Toronto area. And I started this band, Foursquare, with two members of a band called Two Line Filler. And it's sort of like this 90s power pop-y kind of band that I put a demo out to Bad Taste Records in Sweden. And they're like, we want to put this out. So it was one of those things where I was in my 30s in Canada, could not get arrested, and then Europe came calling, because they don't care about how old you are. I mean,
right.
It feels that way. So we put our record out. We put two records on that label. It came out in Japan. And we got a little publishing deal. Like, it turned into, like, a real thing.
Yeah.
And then I had a young kid at the time. And it just, for me, it was like, I wanted to tour, but I couldn't because I had a young child. And it seemed very, very, you know, not a parental thing to do. Musicians are inherently selfish, and I understand that. And I decided that, you know, I'm just going to, I'll keep making songs, but I have to do it on my own merit rather than trying to get a bunch of guys to jump on a plane and fly to Europe and play for no money.
And we'll talk more about Weaker Thans in a future jam that we're going to kick out. But what's after Foursquare for you musically?
I think Foursquare went all the way up to around 2000 and I want to say 2005-ish. Our last record, I toured Europe in 2005. We did some shows. We played two shows with Sum 41. And that's sort of like the way I make contacts is I end up working for the band or I play in one of the bands. So I got this great opportunity to go play what was supposed to be like three or four shows. And then there was that was 2010,
okay.
But we did two shows, but we toured with Sum 41. We played seven shows with them, the original members of the band.
Sure.
And then we ended up I went back there and I put a band together from Italy, which I thought was hilarious because they kind of spoke English and I did not speak Italian. Huh. And we toured around and played shows and yeah.
You might not speak Italian, but do you eat Italian?
Oh, I love Italian.
Would you like a large frozen lasagna from Palma Pasta?
I like where this is going. Absolutely.
I have one in my freezer for you right now, Simon.
Very good. See, I segued. I softballed you.
I was waiting. When will Simon say the word Italian?
We remember our pre-show meeting we had where we were talking about this?
Well, you said Death Cab for Cutie, and I shouted out Ridley Funeral Home. So here, this is another gift for you. This is measuring tape from Ridley Funeral Home. So you got measuring tape from Ridley Funeral Home. You do have a lasagna from Palma Pasta. And I do have, Simon, not just you, not just Ron Hawkins, not just Lawrence Nichols, not just anyone who's listening, but everyone who's listening is invited to TMLX 15 on June 27th. From 6 to 9 p.m., we're at Great Lakes Brewery in Southern Etobicoke. That's at 30 Queen Elizabeth Boulevard. Lawrence and Ron once played live at a TMLX event. I think it was the third one. Hmm. This is the 15th one, and we're all going to just collect. Palma Pasta will feed us. Great Lakes will buy you your first beer. Great Lakes Brewery also has some fresh craft beer that's going home with you, Simon.
Sweet. My son enjoyed it. I kind of quit drinking about 2 years ago. So I brought these home to my son, and he's like, why are they all different? I'm like,
it's like a variety pack.
It's called a variety pack.
Why are they all different?
Figure it out.
It's like a sampler here. So you're bringing that home. You've got a nice assortment there, actually.
I love
it. The Sunnyside for your son, anyway. The Sunnyside Session IPA. You got the Canuck Pale Ale. You have the Premium Lager. And I threw in a Octopus Wants to Fight, one of my favorite IPAs. So bring that home with you. Enjoy. Are you ready for a fourth jam?
Let's do it.
She came all the way from America. She had a blind date with destiny. And the sound of Tiawamutu had a truly sacred ring. Now her parents are divorced and her friends committing suicide. I cannot
Ridley Holmes.
That's a bummer.
What it means to me. Just say I don't walk away. Down on my knees. But please don't be mean to me. So I talked to you for an hour in the bar of a small town hotel. And you asked me what I was thinking. I was thinking of a padded cell. With a black and white TV to stop us from getting lonely.
Digging me some Crowded House here.
Absolutely.
Mean to me. Mean to me. Sorry. Go ahead. Tell me about why you chose this song.
So I was 15 or 16 years old when this record came out. And I remember being in a basement party at my friend Scott McLean's house in Pickering and heard this for the first time. And I thought, this is super fresh. And I had absolutely no idea that it was a split, like it's Neil Finn from Split Enz.
Right.
So I was like, oh, this sounds just like Split Enz. And then I had no idea. And then I went away, bought the record. And then it took me like a couple of times to really like, this is Split Enz. Because I was a huge Split Enz fan, as long as Squeeze and Split Enz, all that type of music was my jam, as they say. And I love this song so much because I saw it live, actually, on this tour. I saw him at Kingswood Music Theater. And we watched it from the grass, not on grass. We watched it from the grass, very back, because I think I just want to see it. And I realized I should have actually been closer to the front because it's a spectacle. Their show is an absolute spectacle. And and I think Toronto really loved Crowded House. Moses Neimer used to let them sleep on the floor of his his apartment or at the Much Music building.
I didn't know that. Yeah. That's a fun fact.
Yeah, and they just had like these they would just
I believe it. He's famous for having a bed in his in his office.
Where are you going with this?
No, I'm not going anywhere. Listen, I'm not going anywhere. He's got lots of lawyers. I'm just saying. I understand he has had a bed in his office. Yeah. So the Crowded House could sleep there.
So people would sleep in the Much Music building. And
299 Queen Street West.
Absolutely. And I think when they came to Toronto, when I saw them, they had just played the Phoenix like 3 or 4 months before. Well, I think was it called the Phoenix? Back then? I don't know.
The Diamond.
The Diamond Club.
Diamond Club, yeah.
So they had just played like a smaller venue, and then they blew up, like Don't Dream It's Over absolutely exploded and became like, this is going to be the big thing.
Right.
And the band,
they were riding that In Excess wave.
Okay? The
Aussie experience.
Absolutely. And it was just such a fresh album. I remember listening to that album all the way through, and I had it on cassette. I've had it on CD. I've bought the stream. Crowded House is putting out a brand new record like on the 31st called Gravity Stairs.
Cool.
Yeah, and they've been playing it and promoting it. And the cool thing about Crowded House is that both of his sons are in the band. His son Elroy's drumming, and his other son,
that's cool,
Liam, is playing guitar, lead guitar, and Mitchell Froom is playing keyboards. Unbelievable.
Unbelievable. I have a question about Subversives. Have you heard of this documentary?
Never heard of it. I heard it sucked. I heard it was too long, by about 10 minutes.
Which 10 minutes?
you decide.
I like how Art Bergman's just sitting outside his Alberta stead or whatever.
Wasteland.
It's like, oh, there's Art Bergman's. And it's like, yeah, there's Art Bergman. Now he's moved back to Vancouver now.
But, yeah.
Sadly, his wife passed away very suddenly. But Art Bergman, by the way, one of my favorite Toronto Mike guests of all time was Art in this basement. And just like, the roller coaster ride that was Art in the basement. You got to check that out when you get a chance.
He said it was like one of the best interviews he's ever done.
He said that, but then I wonder if he says that to every interviewer. Like maybe that's his line because he told me straight up that was the best interview I've ever done.
That's amazing. Now,
and at first I was really flattered by it. I think Alan Zweig was less flattered because I think he's working on a documentary about Art Bergman. He's like, wait a minute.
Yeah.
But I then thought, oh, maybe that would be something you would say to every interviewer and they would feel great about it. Like, you know what I mean? Like I would drop that line after every interview.
I don't think Art panders to anybody.
No, you're right. I realize now Art, that's not Art's style.
No, he's not. I think I'll tell my Art Bergman story.
Yeah, let's hear it.
Because I flew to Calgary and then I flew to Vancouver to meet with Art and then with Frank Weipert. And then inadvertently I ended up meeting with Dave Genn. I land in Calgary and I'm sitting there and I'm texting over like email. Like, I don't have a phone number. And I'm texting through his wife Shelley's email and I'm like, I hope we get this because I've just landed.
Sherry.
Okay. And so
I'm the fact checker here.
Thank you. So I get in the rental car and I drive out where he gives me the address and I find the place. I drive up, knock on the door and he comes out and he's in pajamas.
Right.
I go, Art, how you doing? He goes, oh, pretty good. Can we go buy some beer? I'm like, okay. So I take him up the road to buy beer.
Right.
We scout out places and where we are at is like this old barn, this old like acreage and this old farm.
Right.
And it's got his old truck there and all sorts of crazy stuff. And he gets into one of the buildings, starts climbing up one of the trees. And he has scoliosis. Like he could break his back. Like if he fell,
cane, right?
Just if he fell off to the floor.
Right.
And I have like an iPhone, him like trying to like monkey up this fucking tree. And he gets, and then, so we do the interview and I soon realized like, this is now, Art doesn't know much about Lowest to the Low, but he likes talking on camera.
And he knows they wrote a song about him.
He knows that part. Right. But I have a 45-minute interview of Art, just Art talking about Art. And then all the footage, which I think he's in there for 10 seconds, that's all he talked about, the low. And I did fly there, did on a plane.
But did you consider another document, beating Alan to the punch and doing a documentary about R. Bergman? Because he is a fascinating subject.
I did think about that. And actually, it's funny you'd say that because people have said, there's some people saying, you should just do one on art because art's a great guy. I said, I think there already is one started on art. I think.
Well, you know what? I'm going to beat you both. And I'm just going to take that greatest interview we ever did and chop it up. And I have visuals of that. And I think that'll be my documentary on Art Bergman.
You got AI. You know, you could do some sort of animation like that Oasis doc where it's just none of them in there.
Right.
It's just like animation and them talking.
Right.
No problem. Yeah, I'll help you with that.
Yeah, absolutely. So I'm going to release my Art Bergman documentary soon. I'm going to beat Alan. I'm going to beat you. But Art, fascinating character. And he wouldn't pander to anybody. So,
no.
And you know, we mentioned that Crowded House sleeping at 299 Queen Street West. And now I have a question for you. So 299 Queen Street West was a documentary. I say was. I mean, it exists somewhere on someone's hard drive somewhere.
Somewhere now.
But I've seen it because it was a
You went to the premiere,
I went to the Roy Thompson Hall premiere. Yeah. And Sean Menard directed it, and he is an FOTM, and he invited me. And I enjoyed being there for that. And by the way, Mark Jordan was there.
Oh, did he say hi?
He does. He's an FOTM, so he said hi.
There you go.
In his sleepy way.
He's like, what's Simon up to? He hasn't called me in a while.
And then I said, I'm going to make a Mark Jordan documentary and beat Simon to the punch. And then I found out you abandoned it anyway. Okay, so where I'm going with this is Crave was promoting the fact they were going to stream 299 Queen Street West, and they promoted this fact. This was happening on a Friday or something, and it never actually appeared on the service. And then, you know, a couple of days goes by, it's still not there. Apparently, there was music licensing issues. They'd have, you know, Britney Spears would be singing a song, and they thought they could just do that without clearing it or whatever because of fair use, which may probably, I don't know, I'm not a lawyer, but I don't think that actually exists. And I don't think that's a thing. But they got some bad advice from maybe an American lawyer. Yada, yada, yada. I'm trying to get Sean to tell me what's going on, but he's very quiet about all this. But bottom line is, you can't see 299 Queen Street West right now. So when you do a documentary about Lois the Low, and you're going to have all the music in there from Shakespeare, My Butt, etc., like, do you have to license these songs? Like, what is the, and again, I'm curious, like, to be above board, what is the process for using Rosie and Gray in your documentary?
It was a simple email to Ron saying, oh, can I use all the music that you have? All of it? And he goes, absolutely. And I'm like, I think it needs to be more legal than that.
Well, does Ron own his, I don't even know.
Ron owns all of his own publishing.
Shakespeare My Butt's masters or whatever.
Yeah, he owns all the publishing to it. There's nobody, he doesn't answer anybody for the rights of the music. Now, if 299 used his song on one of his songs, then might be an issue.
Of course.
But I feel that, you know, this is like a spit handshake. I was like, hey, over the phone, like we weren't in spit handshake. I said, Ron, we need to make this legitimate because you need to say, like, I do give you permission to use all this music.
Right.
And actually Brian Heatherman, who from, I'm blanking on the Sonic Envy, owns the, he bought the masters. So for me to use like a Blu-ray, I need to pay a mechanical royalty.
Okay.
Every time there's a, and then we settled on a price, and it was like, it's a nice meal at the Keg, what it costs, you know.
Fascinating, because I was openly wondering, like, if I were going to make a documentary and I wanted, a documentary about Toronto Mike, let's say, that's very self-serving.
There could be one in the making, Mike.
Is that your next, you said no, you said New
York.
Let's
talk off camera.
Right. So if there's a documentary about Toronto Mike, and then, you know, I happen to close every episode of Rosie and Gray from Shakespeare My Butt, and I want that in the documentary, that will be available on DVD, and I want to be above board, because I've been known to not follow rules, and I'm trying to do it properly. I would have to pay something, some mechanical royalty or whatever you call it, to whoever owns the masters of Shakespeare My Butt.
Yeah, and it's not
enough for Ron to say you can use it for me to put this on DVD.
No, and they would make a performance royalty, because if it's played and it's SOCAN has the music, or ASCAP, or whoever owns the rights to the player's rights.
Gotcha.
Then they would then monitor it and then make a price that would you pay into it, whatever that SOCAN fee is, which it's weird. It's like some weird algorithm that's been around for ages. But the whole idea of what's called fair dealing in Canada is that it's not supposed to support the script, the show. It's only supposed to be as hide of what's actually happening. So if you said, I show a little bit of the Kumbaya Festival in the documentary, but it has nothing to do with the story of this. And that's called Fair Dealing. You know, even though I specifically took the music out because I didn't want, you know what I mean? There were certain things that I did that I was sort of,
Shout out to Molly Johnson.
Yeah. I had some very nice counsel with, from David Quinton Steinberg.
Oh yeah. Good FOTM.
Absolutely. And I sort of said, you know, there's a few things as they talk about, like, you know, there's a little bit of slander, but, on one of the, producer on the second album,
Oh yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
And Don, what I found out, yeah, Don Smith. Yeah. And what you can't, apparently what he said is like, well, you can slander dead people.
Right.
Just can't, you just got to be true.
Yeah, of course. Of course. And I know exactly that. Ron's told that story on Toronto Mic'd, but he said some not very progressive things about people of color, if I remember correctly.
Yes. And also, I think when you're dealing with the size of what I'm releasing, we're very small, you know, there's a very small eyeglass on it. So nobody's going to like, hold on a second, what's this lowest of the low, like selling millions of units? I'd imagine so if it turned into something huge.
What you're saying is if your doc was about Britney Spears, for example, that's a different arena.
It's very hard because she doesn't own any of her music. She doesn't write any of it. Right. And to get use of it, that's why you have like, there's some great YouTube like documentary style that on the Beatles and it's like all sound alike.
Right.
And it's like, oh, what a letdown.
Right, and that's why my Toronto Mic documentary, I realize now, I got to pay in lasagna, so whoever owns the masters for Rosie and Gray, I can get you some Palma pasta.
There you go, I love it.
And some fresh craft beer here. Hey, let's kick out another jam, and then I'm going to pester you with more questions. Let's and I have it. More gifts for you, and I got gifts coming my way, can't wait. Let's kick it.
You're a few years overdue. I spent them waiting here for you. Now your charity's refused. I can't name a penance for abuse.
Group, I have to plead a little ignorance here. I'm not cool like you, Simon. Who are we listening to?
This is the Get Up Kids. Get Up Kids started sort of in the mid-90s, sort of on the, like they were a Midwestern emo band that sort of before it had a name. They actually are just celebrating, is it the 25th anniversary of Something to Write Home About, which was like, sounds nothing like this. And they put a record out like this was completely opposite to what people were expecting. And it's a great record. It's so good. Like, I can't believe, like, they would just sort of do it. The next record they put out was called Guilt Show because people were, like, saying, give us Get Up Kids, you know.
Right.
And they still put records out. And this band kind of started, like, that sort of era of, like what's his name from My Chemical Romance? They hired the keyboard player in this band to take on tour during the Black Parade tour. So they're a huge, influential band that no one really has heard of. And this song is like one of those songs you hear and you're like, oh.
Yeah, it's a great song. Overdue. Great.
Yeah.
Beautiful. Okay, and you're introducing me. What I like about Kick Out the Jams is, yeah, you're going to talk about Squeeze and Elvis Costello and Death Cab for Cutie and Crowded House, but then I'm going to learn about the Get Up Kids. And
it was a tough list to make, man.
How, like, did you go through iterations?
Yeah.
You just whittle it down to like 20 and then you're making cuts? How did you do it?
At 10 and then I sort of started, oh, what about this song? So then I'm like, well, what song doesn't belong here anymore?
Right.
And so I kept it to 10 because otherwise it would just be like too much to...
And when you're cutting it to 10, are you thinking about, I would like to tell a story about this? Like, is there any of that thought process going on?
Yeah, like, absolutely. Okay. Like there's for me, it's like there's parts like if I could play Number of the Beast by Iron Maiden, that's like a huge, that's a change in my life of where my musical taste went to.
But that's not on your list.
No, it's not on my list because it's like there's a few songs on there that should be on there. And I thought, oh, if it was like an era of my life, then I could definitely focus in. Because life changed in the late 80s. For me, mid 80s to late 80s was a huge change in my musical tastes. And I was introduced to a lot more music because I wanted to find it rather than what my brothers would let make me listen to.
Right, yeah.
You know, like as a kid, it was all like Rush and Bob Seger and all these weird, like ZZ Top and all these like bands. You're like, yeah, they were cool. Or Leonard Skinner, like my brothers love Leonard Skinner. Like, yeah. Well, I like Leonard Skinner because my brother liked Leonard Skinner. But I must say that I introduced my brothers to Stevie Ray Vaughan.
There you go. Double trouble.
Yeah, right.
Okay, the late great shout out to FOTM Colin James.
He is
mentored by that gentleman. It was pointed out in the live stream that you and I have a little bit of a link that we both kind of worked at the CNE. Because I was working as a game booth attendant as a teenager, and I remember that day working at the CNE when they told me that Stevie Ray Vaughan had died in a plane crash. Like, yeah. I remember that day.
Yeah, yeah. No, that's it's hilarious that they still do the CNE, even though that the things are all sort of like being built around it, that it's becoming like it's smaller and smaller. The carnies are still there, though.
The Conklin guys are never going anywhere.
Like all the trailers, they purposely take the wheels off so no one will like take the trailer while they're sleeping in it.
I've shared these stories many times and people can find them, but I had great experiences with the Conklin carnies because I worked for a different outfit called Astro Zodiac Enterprises, owned and operated by Ardo Gadaro, the scariest man I ever met, actually. But he scared the shit out of us.
Did you have to join Scientology to
Astro Zodiac? No, he has a great name, actually.
It's a pretty rad name.
Yeah, I think I even at some point asked him for the origin of the name. And there's an episode from last October with Ardo and his son because I needed to face my fear. I was so scared of this man. I was only 15 years old, but he scared the shit out of me. Ardo Gadaro. Even now thinking about him, I'm like pissing my pants.
That's his real name, Ardo Gadaro.
Ardo Gadaro.
That's a good punk rock name, actually.
you can borrow that name, right?
Ardo Gadaro.
Ardo Gadaro. And he used to just yell at us kids, man. He was a scary guy, too. My goodness. We're going to another jam. And then after this jam, before the next jam, I'm going to give you another gift. And then you can give me my gifts. And I hope you're enjoying yourself because I'm enjoying this.
This is awesome.
Simon Head kicking out the jizz. One ancient head, everybody, if you're Googling him. Here we go.
School.
Oh, that's your theme song. Okay.
Theme. I'm sure you don't remember me. And now it's been 10 years.
Long intros in my jams.
And I'd love to mix in circles, clicks, and social coteries. That's me. Hand me my nose ring.
Then we'd be happy.
Show me the mosh pit.
Then we'd be happy.
You ready?
We can't be happy underground.
Woo! This is a key slinger.
He's a key slinger. That's what we call slinging keys.
Right.
Who's got the looks? Who's got the brains? Who's got everything? I got this pain in my heart. That's all. Hey, you with the lonely, lonely face. There's gotta be some. A girl that passed me by, she gave a smile, but I was shy. And I looked down, so down.
Don't look down, no, no. Go underground.
And now there's a place to go. It's the morning now.
Think about Ben Folds 5. They write recognizable songs that. And that you can sort of associate other times in your life.
Yeah.
Like that rundown is from something. And they also, like, Ben Folds is famous for writing songs that kind of sound like something, but he puts his own twist on it.
And I love sequencing. Like, there's always a method to the madness when it comes to sequencing. And, you followed up Overdue with a song called Underground.
That was not intentional, I must say. Thank you for making me... No, let's recut that. Yeah, I went out of my way to make songs like that.
Sometimes it's subconscious, Simon.
Absolutely.
So Ben Folds 5. Have you seen Ben Folds live?
Oh, yeah. I've seen Ben Folds 5. I saw Ben Folds 5 on the Whatever and Ever tour at Lee's Palace.
Right.
June 6th, 1997.
Wow.
Forever changed my life. There's actually something happened that day that was like one of my best friends was actually killed at work. He died in an
God.
He was electrocuted. And I heard this bad news.
That's traumatic.
It was very traumatic. And then I went and I lived in the city at the time, and my girlfriend, now wife, we sat there and we got wasted at the studio. And then I went to go see Ben Folds 5. And we missed the first couple of songs. And there's an Elliot Lefko tie in here because his sister was running the door. And I was like, she's like, well, you can't get in. The guest list is closed. I said, well, the tour manager put us on because the tour manager, Ben Folds, was the tour manager at one point for Cannibal Corpse. So there was this weird tie-in I had with, so I got on the guest list, and then I sort of had to say, well, something very bad happened to me. You have to let me in. So we got in and we watched the show, and it just, for a little while in my life, was just like, oh, this is great. And how I discovered them was, there's a guy named Ed Dobek, was in a band called Junior Run Wild, original member.
Yeah.
And he had this record in 94 or 5. And I was touring with SNFU, and he made a copy of it for us, and we just listened the shit out of this record on this one tour we did. And it's this record is just so good. And this is the pure version that Ben Folds always sort of sometimes comes back to, which is this sort of three guys, piano, bass, and drums.
Honestly, got a lot of time for Ben Folds, and this is fantastic.
Yeah.
Digging this so much. And your friend dying, that's awful, man.
It was
that's
bad. Awful. It was very bad. And it was like, you know, not a day goes by, but you think, and it was sort of pre, like, you know, when there was like a health and safety.
Like when those PSAs would run with that, I still am haunted because a woman in a restaurant was carrying hot grease or something and slips in it.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God, I'm haunted. Like, I could just get shivers, man.
Yeah. There's like this type of like, there's no joint health and safety committee. And in sort of the whole thing at the end of that is that the company you worked for was held liable because he was wearing shorts. And you shouldn't be wearing shorts, and you should be standing on a rubber.
That's why you have safety standards. Yeah. You have to.
So the standards was he grounded out and he died.
Oh my God.
And this is one of those things, you know, and he was 29, you know, and it's like now he'd be, you know, it was a long time ago now.
It's terrible.
20 something plus.
That's terrible. That's far more terrible than this fact I'm going to share. I learned on the live stream, which is that Conklin's not at the CNE anymore. Did you know that?
I did not know that. I should know that, but I don't know that.
Yeah. So I'm going back to the, when was I? Early 90s. Actually, 89, 90, 91, that kind of era there. I was at the CNE, and Conklin was running the show over there, but they're gone, apparently.
What is it now?
I don't know, but those carnies are something else.
They probably got absorbed into like some other type of...
Where are the Conklin carnies? We got to find out.
Where are your original guys? Looking, I can tell he's not no teeth and he's missing an ear.
Oh, they were the best, though. I needed their help one day. There's a drunken boyfriend of this woman I went to see a Blue Jay game with at the Dome, and went to a pizza party before because I got these tickets for being on the mic. And I still remember he was coming for me. He was inebriated, and he was coming for me very late as I was closing up my booth. I was a little skinny 15-year-old kid, or maybe 16 that year. But I remember asking the carnies for help, and they looked at me and said, "You work for Ardo?" And I said, "Yeah." And they said, "Okay, boys, you want to fight?" And he was pounding this pipe into his hand.
Oh my God.
And I know. And the carnies came to basically rescued me. Like, say, and then that guy never bothered me again. So
that's,
I don't know,
so
what the carnies
cool.
did. This story, oh my God, I could tell you this. Tales from the X. I've been used to write about this, but I got to do a whole series, Tales from the X. Maybe when the CNE comes back, I'll do it. But I have a gift for you. Before we go to Winnipeg and kick out this great jam, I would love to give you the history of the Toronto Maple Leafs baseball team. That book is going home with you, Simon.
Amazing. And I will get through it rather than that Elvis Costello book.
Well, there's a lot of fun facts in there. A lot of good Toronto history. It's not as dense as the Elvis one.
Does it get into Mighty Like a Rose era? Because that's where I tuned out.
That's right. You should know, and the listenership should know, that I will be at Christie Pitts on Sunday to not only throw out the first pitch, but then I'm going to record live beyond the left field fence. And I realize, like, I've been so busy, like, family and episodes and things and production and all this stuff. I forgot to actually, like, book guests for Sunday. So I got to find some interesting cats who want to chat with me live from Christie Pitts on Sunday. This is on my to-do list. So reach out. I'm thinking maybe, is Tyler Stewart in town or is he at his cottage? I need some people who can waltz over to Christie Pitts.
You should get Manfred. Well, like, Manfred lives sort of far away.
Well, that's it. I need somebody who can
get
to Christie Pitts. Oh, yeah, Manfred's
He's left-handed,
you
too.
You do know he's an FOTM.
And he's left-handed.
Okay, well,
that makes him super unique.
That makes him super unique. He's an FOTM, and of course, Manfred. Now, he comes to many a TMLX event. Love that guy. He knows that. So you're going to learn about the Toronto Maple Leafs baseball. People should check out Toronto Maple Leafs baseball live at Christie Pitts. There's no ticket. You just show up. There's good food, good drink, and you get great baseball. And
is there food trucks?
There's food trucks. Yeah, absolutely. There's a brewery, not Great Lakes Brewery, but another fine brewery called Left Field Brewery are providing the food and the drink. You can drink legally alcohol while sitting on the hill and watching some semi-pro baseball, best baseball in the city outside the dome. Before I get my gift. Okay, this is interesting. This book here, this is not a sponsor. I took $0 and 0 cents. But I said, hey, you're publishing your own book. And if I can just shout it out by giving a copy to my guests.
Sweet.
And so Bruce Dobigan, who's an FOTM, a great writer, him and his son wrote this book about the best, basically it's about the biggest hockey trades. And they dive into this called Deal With It about hockey trades. And the Gilmore trade is in there, of course. Shout out to Killer, number 93.
Put in there.
Yeah, there you go. Okay, so Deal With It is available now. They published this. This is a father and son who wrote this and published it. And get a copy and support these independent writers.
That's so cool. Father and son team.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that.
It's cool. So no, in fact, not only did I not take any money to give out this book, but I gave them beer and pasta. So
nice.
It's like
there you go.
Literally, what a deal they had.
You're a philanthropist.
You ready to go to Winnipeg?
Let's do
this. Okay.
My city is still breathing, but barely, it's true. Through buildings gone missing like teeth, the sidewalks are watching me think about you. Sparkled with broken glass, I'm back with scars to show. Back with the streets I know will never take me anywhere but here.
No chorus in this song either, really.
The Weaker Thans were great.
Yeah.
Left and Leaning.
Leaving.
Left. Yeah, what did I say?
Leaning.
Oh, Left and Leaving, right. Left and Leaning is how I
that's the,
I operate.
It's the second single. Left Leaning.
Let's dedicate this song to many big fans of the show, but let's dedicate it to Tim Thompson, Boundless.
Nice.
I know he makes a lot of stuff for Lowest of the Low.
Yeah.
All right, talk to me
about
the Weaker Thans.
So, I think I mentioned before, I used to play in a band with Jason Tate from the Weaker Thans called Red Fisher. And I left Winnipeg as Junkie Samson had already released like a solo thing. He was still kind of in Propaganda. And he had just left Propaganda and started this Weaker Thans band. They recorded, and in 1997, I was living in Toronto, and John Sutton, who was a bass player.
Who's in FOTM.
He is.
Because he's even rusty now.
He is, and he was my roommate in Winnipeg. He's like, we're looking for, when I lived in Winnipeg, so we're mixing our record, Fallow, at Phase One Studios, got somewhere, let's see, come stay at my place. So they stayed in our one-bedroom apartment, all three of them. I don't think Steve was even in the band at that point. And they go mix their record at Phase One, then come back to our apartment and listen to their mixes on our cassette player. And I remember our landlord lived in the main floor. He locked us out because he thought we were getting like roommates. I'm like, no, these are just visiting. So they locked the door on us.
That's not legal.
No. Well, luckily it was the summer. So so we had to beg him to let us come back into our own apartment.
That's wild.
So, but the first time I heard this song is when they did the Real Statics did a residency at Ted's, and I saw them play this song for the first time. And at the time, they stayed at my studio, I think, at Ossington and Dundas. And the first time I saw this song, I wept. I openly wept. And I told Ian Blurton this because we had worked together on a Foursquare record. And I said, I talked about it. He goes, dude, I was there recording it. He was bawling as he was, the words that John K. Samson pulls from this are just such good imagery and such a, just paints pictures with minimal words. And I really appreciate that for someone to create, you know, movies in your head on just simple words.
Beautiful song. Just tremendous. And now I'm thinking, okay, so John P. Sutton, now with Rusty. How do we get like a lowest of the low Rusty double bill somewhere? Like, how do I make that happen?
They're doing a show, actually. Aren't they doing something on
Rusty?
Yeah, next week they're doing like an Oshawa show.
Yeah, I did definitely saw the poster. Yeah, because I follow Scotty Mac on the socials and I saw that poster. But
I think it'd be easier than you think because I think Rusty's back to playing shows. I used to work for Rusty. I was their sound guy.
Okay, what era exactly?
Early 2000s.
Early 2000s. Yeah. Okay.
I left Rusty to go work for Treble Charger. Sideways move.
How come it took so long to get to get these names out of you? Treble Charger, I love Treble Charger. Red is still one of the great.
It's a good song. They could have recorded it just once, though.
That's true. They're the most. The Rusty, though, so that's because they're... When was Empty Cell was on the follow-up to Fluke, which is the album I keep going back to. But that's sort of like Lowest Low. I love Lowest of Low albums beyond Shakespeare My Butt. But for some reason, I keep going back to Shakespeare My Butt. Tell Ron I do that, okay?
Well, you just told everybody. I'm just
he's not listening.
This is live.
Lawrence might be listening, but I bet you Ron's not hearing this. But Rusty, similar story in that I always go back to Fluke.
Yeah, and the second record they did was the one that was more sort of 60s based. I think Matt DiMatteo produced it. That's sort of when I worked for them. Was that late 90s? I want to say that was like 98, 99.
Because they don't last much longer, do they? I feel like they break up shortly thereafter.
There was an issue, I think. Yeah, early 2000s, I think. I ended up going out on tour with Sum 41 for like 2 years.
Wow. There's a band of big American hits.
Right? And then, I remember them. I heard stories, which I don't need to share, but there were some sort of weird, crazy stories that were like happening with the band. And that was, they are the Art Bergmans of Toronto. I mean, a lot of crazy stuff, a lot of crazy stories. And they are famous for that type of like just being rusty. Yeah, you can't
beat Ken, I know Ken was working as like a short order cook in Bloor West Village shortly after Rusty kind of dissolved or whatever.
He's up in Sudbury now. I think he works in the nickel mine.
I think he's a bricklayer.
Bricklayer, oh.
Maybe he's both.
We should have played Brick by Ben Folds 5. That would have really tied
all
this together.
Too sad. Too sad. Brick. We go play Army, okay? That's Dice is on your fucking... Okay. Great jam there. Okay, so shout out to Rusty. There's a lot of ground we're covering here, but Weaker Than's, John K. Sampson. That's beautiful.
They got
to
play more shows. I think they haven't officially broken up, but they've officially stopped playing shows.
More songs about cats and stuff.
More songs about cats. And yeah, I mean... I love the fact that Propaganda was just such a politically based, everything was like, here's some facts. And then they go, anchorless. It's like, wow, they're so vast and crazy that John had to break out on his own and do
stuff. Well, if you see a Lowest of the Low show, Ron Hawkins has that sticker, has the Propaganda sticker on his guitar.
Yeah. I saw Propaganda one of the first times they played in Toronto and they played the Alma Combo and it was a shit show. Like, it was really like, it was, and they actually got off this one tour after their first album and they realized like they didn't know how to play shows. So they actually practiced like every day, like a job. They go in and they would practice for like 8 hours a day, have lunch. And then they became like all talk, more rock. Was that the album?
Yeah. Something like that.
No talk. Yeah. Less talk, more rock.
Talk, more rock.
And then they just became this crazy juggernaut of a band.
All right. Let's kick out your anti-penultimate jam. And then after this jam, I want my gifts.
Anti-penultimate. Okay,
Simon, anti-penultimate.
Okay.
You can
add
that to your lexicon.
Last July.
Oh, yeah. Shorty Sampson.
I drank a bottle of Wolf Blast and passed out in the tall grass on Portobello Road. Yeah, the sky was light.
Got right to business that way.
Yeah.
You're gonna be my great regret, though I guess it hasn't hit me yet. Slow drag on the last cigarette, just a good excuse to take off.
nowhere to give you the weather and the time.
Yeah. Skin condition.
The sports the Stars beat the Oilers last night.
Oh yeah.
My wife's from Edmonton, so we're following these Oilers, and now
what is it 2-1 now? What is
2-1
it?
Dallas? Yeah. And they got another game coming up in Edmonton before they go back to Dallas. But Edmonton's got to win this game.
Oil will come back. They don't actually.
I gotta say, I've seen a lot of Oilers. Now, the Leafs didn't look very good, and they would have got killed by Florida in the next round if we had got by Boston in the first round. They would have got smoked by Florida, I think. But Edmonton doesn't look that impressive to me. Like I feel like Dallas should win this series in like 5 or 6 games. But
I am a bandwagon jumper. Yeah. I don't follow the season. I should because it sort of makes me inherently Canadian.
Well, you're not missing much.
No, I know it's true. It's like. You know what? Actually, I used to go to the Maple Leafs games like at the Gardens when I was like 8 and 9 years old because the family around the corner from us had a nanny, and the nanny would take me to because they had season's tickets in the Grays on center line. So it was I'd go and I'd watch games like 2 or 3 a week. It felt like
the Norris Division battles.
Yeah,
right.
And before they had the net around the where people get pinged with.
Yeah.
I saw a lady get pinged so bad. It was during warm up, and they were playing the Kings, and he just deflected it, and I saw it go, and just, and it was like the JFK assassination. Like it felt like the, bam.
Yeah, there's a Zapruder film there. Absolutely. The second spitter theory. If we go back to Seinfeld. Okay, so I want to hear about Gordy Sampson, but I want my gift.
Like, okay.
I'm worried you're going to forget to give me my gift.
What do you want, the gift first, or you want the Gordy Sampson story?
Let's do Gordy first.
Okay, so first time I heard Gordy. Gordy used to be in Ashley McIsaac's band. He also is responsible for writing Jesus Take the Wheel. So he wrote that Faith Hill song.
I feel I knew that from Kim Stockwood. I feel like I got that.
So he's this great songwriter who lived the Ashley McIsaac dream as well as I did for a brief period of time. I was Ashley's minder.
Because he came within a whisker of being here very recently.
Who, Ashley?
Yeah,
he does not do interviews. He'd be my Elliot Lefko, like, for you.
Okay, well, it almost happened, like, unless I was misled by, I think it was Jane Harbury who was setting this up from the Hughes Room. But please continue, because he's an interesting cat.
So I heard Gordy Sampson on Q with our friend Gian Gameshi. And I saw, what I witnessed was a masterclass in how to do an interview with Gian Gameshi. It was this brilliant, beautiful orchestration of like, I'm not putting up with your shit.
And, amazing.
And I saw that and I thought, oh, that's so cool. and so I wasn't really a fan. I heard the music during the show. I'm like, that's just kind of cool. But I bring myself to musicians that I like as people and I'll like their music more.
Of course. Yeah. I think that's natural. And it's funny that we opened up, started by talking about Head with 2 H's and Noah Mintz, because when Noah Mintz was on Toronto Mike, he went off on, they went to high school together
in
Thornlie, I think it is, or some Thornhill high school, far, far away from here. But he went off on Gian Gameshi and it was priceless. Like go back to Noah Mintz just to hear the Gian Gameshi track.
You should throw that in that tirade. I have a story. The Gian Gameshi story, the joke I made was that I still haven't forgiven you for Moxie Fruvis. That was the joke. And there was a stand-up comic playing the theater I used to work at. And I told him that joke and he told it live. he stole my joke. It was like, yeah, I still have it. And then I started getting during that whole thing. And it's tragic. Cause he's a fucking monster. But, you know, you can slander Gian Gameshi now, right?
Yeah, yeah. He was...
His mom might say, hey, Gian...
He was not convicted. We just need to point out he was not convicted.
No. But I actually... There's certain people that I spoke to who were like... who used to date him that tell crazy stories. And I'm like, oh, yeah, okay, no more. But anyways, yeah. Pizza, Gian Gameshi... what is it? The Moxie Fruvis.
Yeah.
Not my jam.
I will say this. For a little while, I did like Stuck in the 90s, but I think it's, I don't know. But for a little while, I did think that was a good song. I'm just putting that out there.
That's okay. I don't judge. It's fine.
Yes, you're judging me right now.
I'm going to unfriend you right now. You're judging me right now.
I will say, though, I was looking at your coffee cup, which you got from a local independent coffee shop, and I see there's marketing's everywhere.
I saw it.
Ads are everywhere. Yeah, there's literally, I wonder, like, okay, we'll buy you independent coffee shop. We'll buy you the cups. But we're going to put it's Charmin or whatever.
Here's another one. He was at some coffee snob kind of like trade show and they were giving out free samples of what we have as these things. And he's like, I'm going to grab a handful of these because these are free. These things cost
maybe,
money.
Because, you know, independent coffee shops, bless their hearts, right? You got to compete with the Starbucks
what's
and all
called
these
big little man. Is that what it's called? Big little man?
Big little guys?
Big
or,
little
no,
guy.
Big guys?
Big little guy or big, big guys or whatever. Guys or we're fucking but that up.
Three big guys, maybe. Three big guys?
No, I think what? It's called okay. Big. I but, found it because I'm like, where's the closest coffee?
Well, when Steve Anthony was here, he said, hey, is there a coffee shop I could have a meeting at? And I sent him there because I like the
it's
the
got a bookstore kind of yeah. attached to it. And it's like, and they play cool music. And the guy is a big guy. So yeah, there's no false advertising going there. He's actually a big guy.
But it's wild for me to see they're advertising a Kleenex or something on the side of that thing. And then I was thinking, oh, I'm going to see Neil Young at the Budweiser stage in early July. And he refuses to have it referred like when he negotiated this deal, they aren't going to call it Budweiser Stage for his show. It's like because he won't do anything with the brand Budweiser or yeah. whatever.
It's in his song,
you.
I think, isn't it?
This note's for you.
Yeah.
Ain't singing for Pepsi, ain't singing for Coke. But then he won't even let them sell Budweiser beers at his concert. So this is kind of the
interesting.
Neil Young,
the power he wields. Is he yeah. driving his electric car to the show?
Yeah,
because he remember, I read that book. That book's a tough read.
Okay, I don't know if he is or not, but maybe he's flying his electric plane or something there. I don't know, because he's doesn't. I don't know. I thought like, he spent a lot of time during the pandemic in the Kawarthas. Yeah.
Up with Omimi area?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I know people in the Kawarthas would do like Neil Young spotting, like, oh, he's at this restaurant or whatever. Like, I'm supposed to bike over there and say hi or something like that. Okay, this is the... So we did the anti-penultimate. This is the penultimate jam, but you still haven't given me the gifts. Like,
oh,
should
yeah.
I play
okay.
this
Let's do
and
the
get
gift.
The gift?
Let's do the gift. Okay, that first gift forget. I have is, this is produced by Ian Blurton.
Oh, I love that guy.
The first Foursquare album.
Okay,
I found
cool.
it in our basement, along with 499 item. Of them. And I actually, funny, I threw out half of them because it's like, what am I going to do with 400
CDs?
We know
what you do. You bring them to TMLX15 and everybody
Hand
gets a copy.
And they go, what do you want me to do with this? I don't have a thing.
Someone at
anymore.
TMLX15 will
they'll
be like, that's amazing.
They'll try to jam it into their phone. I think eventually, now that I have this other thing I'm doing musically, I'm going to probably start a Spotify thing and put it on Spotify because it's not on Spotify. It's a very...
I'm the only one with. I'm going to have to share.
You are
it on
the only one in Canada
you know,
right
I can,
now.
I can play a CD on this thing I'm pointing to, and I can pipe it through the channel here. So theoretically, I could play a CD.
Technically,
on this
you could. It's yeah. You know, the funny thing is, it's probably it's been there in my crawl space. No, it's been in our baby barn, which has I think some a family of skunks under, and you know,
let me smell this.
It doesn't
CD
smell like skunk.
Okay.
And so the next thing I have is
oh, there's more.
Is the actual physical copy of Subversive's
oh, wow.
The History of Los Alo on wow. Blu-ray disc.
So this is like hot off the press, right?
It is. I went and picked it up this morning. At,
are there? Because I know you. Put on social media, you were going to check it to see if there were any typos. Did
yeah,
you
yeah.
find any?
No, I haven't opened it
Lucky
yet.
For you, I'm not wearing my glasses. Like, I actually cannot read that right now. I'd have to put it back there and then
the,
I can read
There's
it.
Some funny stories behind the proofing of that because the lady I spoke to who was sort of my rep for to deal with this release was, she's like, I was a huge Ronnie Hawkins fan.
Oh, I know where you're going
I'm like, which Ronnie are you talking about? Well, yeah, one of those stuff he does. Well, I hate to burst your bubble, lady, but
the band.
This is the different. This isn't that Ronnie Hawkins you speak so highly of. And from there, I mean, it's been a romp. It's been
romp and Ronnie Hawkins.
And there's a funny thing. They gave me some artwork to proof on the back. There's these screen grabs. They sent us all the screen grabs from the movie, and I put them in the back. And when they showed me the artwork that was going to go to print, it was other pictures from another movie. I'm like, I was thinking about maybe I'll just leave that
oh, yeah.
up there.
I see Steven Stanley back here.
Handsome
he's a,
Steve.
He's a good FOTM. Yeah. That's a good boy.
I saw him
right
this
there.
Weekend in my town, actually. And so there was some very funny, like, interesting, like, they've never seen, you could tell, like, no one's watched the movie.
That's it, funny.
Because then the
Not
trailer.
Even, like, for QA purposes, they don't give this a go. But no.
The trailer has, has like a picture of Mike McDonald from Junior Gone Wild, and he's the thumbnail. And I'm like, you know,
he's not in Lois at
the He's not in the band. And anybody who knows that would probably know that that's not the guy. And they go, well, that's for the trailer. So when you go to Apple TV, you see
oh,
a picture
funny.
Of Mike McDonald from Junior Gone Wild. And I've been trying. I've been
Good
lobbying.
Help is hard to find.
I'm
right?
lobbying so you know hard. What? Like, can you just get him out of there?
You just need someone who gives a shit.
Absolutely.
Like, I've noticed this in my, I've been living in this world now, running my own show since 2018. And the key, the key is giving a shit.
Yeah.
If giving a shit means so much in your attention to detail and making sure that, you know, you have a thumbnail that maybe a thumbnail of like the band playing or something like that. Or
there was
maybe Ron Hawkins. Or
the actual artwork that's
on the actual artwork.
That would be nice.
Shout out to Art Bergman.
It's such a funny, like, I can't speak. These people have taken this huge risk to put this thing out. It's a larger place that's putting out an unobstructed view. And I spoke with FOTM Jonathan Gross.
Oh, yeah.
And he is responsible for this.
Yeah.
And he goes, our big release is Caligula this year. He goes, I was trying to see if I could throw you in with the press and promo.
Right, because it's like the same kind of audience, I think, actually.
Absolutely, yeah. So I was trying really hard to sort of like...
I love Jonathan Gross.
He's amazing.
Sadly, his sister died far too young, but co-wrote the Fusilli Jerry episode of Seinfeld.
Yeah, and it's very funny because I actually called him on the phone and he's so business, right? Because you're like, you know... I can let you off the hook. You don't need to make a Blu-ray. He goes, don't worry, Simon. Everybody's going to make money. I'm like, I'm not worried about making money. I'm worried about losing money.
Right.
That's what I'm worried about.
You got to keep your expectations.
So he's confident that, there's 1,500 of these made. And he's confident.
Well, you sell them at Lois Alo shows, right?
Yeah, at least two or three per show.
When is the next Lois Alo show?
Oh, it's in Buffalo on the 8th.
Oh, Buffalo.
And I'm not there because I'm riding the ride to conquer cancer that weekend.
Is this your first time? Or you
no, it's my seventh time.
Okay, because I did it once.
Yeah.
And I got a pinched nerve right here. And I said, I think I'll stick to 50-60K rides.
You got
to
come do it next year with us. You join our team, our two left pedals team.
Okay. I mean, 50-60K I'll do just on a Sunday.
Yeah.
But then when I get to over 100, I just find maybe because I just have a $900 bike or whatever.
Yeah.
I'm touching, which no one can see on the podcast.
No,
it just
can.
Gets a pinched nerve and then it takes a week or so.
Maybe it's your setup. Maybe you need to sort of raise your bars maybe.
Well, yeah, but that was many bikes ago, so maybe it's better now.
I was going to actually reach out to you earlier this year to say do you want to do this? Because it'd be fun because we can raise money and it's a good ride. And there's good people every
year. Where do you go
now?
When I did it, we went from Ontario Place to Mohawk College in Hamilton. But
you go to, it's not Mohawk, it's the university.
McMaster. Okay, maybe it's moved.
Yeah, you stay there for the night and then you ride on to Niagara Falls.
Okay, because we had that option, but I then how do I get home?
Ride?
So I know. So you when I did it, we went through Milton, so it was 125K to get there, but we went to Mohawk College.
Yeah.
We spent the night and then the next day came back.
Oh, yeah. Because you can do that. You can actually return, but then they have shuttles now. They give you, put you on a bus and take you back to.
No, that sounds, I would rather just bike it back. Come on. Let's be. You're not taking the shuttle, are you?
I am taking the shuttle.
Okay, no.
It's 230 kilometers over 2 days.
Oh, I know.
Mike.
I know. It was exact. I measured it with my app. It was exactly 226.
Yeah.
Combined.
Yeah. And then they have this one called the Hammer, which is a longer version of the first day, and it takes you an extra.
Well, that's when you go through Milton, right?
Yeah, I think that's the longer ride. And the funny thing, my cousin and I were riding, and we're usually in the back. We're not in a hurry. Right. And then these guys come flying by us and goes, "Well, they must have been lost." And you're like, "No. They just took the long.
They took the long way."
Yeah.
Oh, amazing. And do you have what are you doing this on? Just a regular mountain bike?
I have a giant. I have a giant, just a medium grade
hybrid.
No, it's a road bike.
It's a road bike.
It's the only reason I ride a road bike. I usually ride a hardtail mountain bike through the rail trails up where I live.
Love it.
Which is the Trans-Canada Trail is there. It's this beautiful no cars experience because road bikes in northern part of Durham is some sort of turf war between the dump trucks and the.
Yeah.
And the bike riders. They don't like bike riders. And you know what?
Well, most automobilists don't seem to like
and them. You know what? The bike riders have it coming sometimes because you do that staggered approach
so
you can
packs.
Take half a
they
lane.
Call them the
Peloton or whatever they call it. It's guys, come on. You're not making it. You may make it hard for me because now I go dump trucks. I'm by myself. It's like the Warriors, you're stuck there by yourself. And
yeah, you just want to,
just want to ride, man.
Live to ride another day. Okay, man, that sounds amazing. Good luck to you on the ride to conquer cancer. This is your penultimate jam. By the way, thank you for the gifts. I appreciate it.
Yeah,
and I'm honored. And I'm going to put the DVD on display here as a conversation piece, because that seems to be, I look over and then I suddenly I'm talking.
Because you got nothing to play it on?
Well, no, that is true because I can play a CD on this.
Yeah,
won't
play Blu-rays.
But these laptops we buy in the last 10 years don't come with CD-ROMs. There is nothing in this house right now that will play a DVD, unfortunately.
Now you can sort of put it on display and go, it's just what I thought would happen, actually, mostly.
Well, I mean, I got blown up here by Stu Stone and Jamie Kennedy, and it comes up often because I'm staring at Stu Stone's face over here. All right, let's kick out your penultimate jam.
Yeah, that snare sound.
See a dog up on the road, running hard to catch a cab. Car is pulling to a halt. The truck behind me doesn't know. Of a moment I can't control, and your sympathetic strings are like the stirrings in my soul. Ooh, I could go anytime.
Oh, that riff, riff.
There's nothing safe about this life.
Neil Finn, Anytime.
Yeah. Carrying on with the Crowded House. This is his second solo record that he put out, and called One All. But the Australian in that side of it was called One Nil. I guess they didn't realize what nil meant in North America.
Zero.
Zero, yeah. One All is what it's called. And
but what does nil mean there? Isn't that a soccer term? Like one an international? Nothing. Yes, yeah. Right.
So I guess One All was their sort of... but they, or One Nothing wouldn't work. I guess there was a lot of people talking around a table like, now, Neil, we up here in North America, we talk different. Now, this song, there's actually a version of this that's on a live album that I heard first that has Johnny Marr playing guitar, Ed Steinbeck, and two guys from Radiohead, and a guy from Soul Coffee. It's like this band he put together, Lisa Germano. And it's like, he put a lot, Eddie Vedder sings on it, like it's this sort of, it's called Seven Worlds Collide. And it's the first song on this album that hadn't been released in North America yet. So when I heard this version, I'm like, oh, this is the clean version of it. This is like, you know, Turn the Page by Bob Seger.
Of course.
The live version is the bigger hit than the actual version. When you hear the live version or the real version, you're like, there's something wrong with this.
Right, it's not missing. Yeah.
Yeah, he's talking about the road. So this is sort of like that song that's, and it carries on like Neil Finn, Crowded House, anything he does, he can crap on a piece of vinyl and I'll buy it.
All right, amazing. I mean, just do it at sunrise at Cloverdale Mall.
Live in store. I remember I met Neil Finn at HMV. No, was it Sam's? No, it was either Sam's or HMV on Yonge Street. Sure. And he was doing a record signing and he was playing at the, what's the place around here? The Paradise.
Oh, yeah. I bike by it every fucking day.
Yeah.
And I have a live CD collection from Sloan. Live from the
Palais Royal.
Thank you.
So I was going to see the Palais Royal, and my buddy came with it. We waited in line, and I gave him that Ian Blurton Foursquare.
Yeah.
And he goes, I'm going to listen to this. I'm like, bullshit, you're not going to listen to this. So that's how long ago that was. And then I actually got a guest list for Neil Finn show at the Palais Royal, because I actually had mixed... I mixed a show there for Ashley McIsaac just out of the blue. And there was a guy, George, that ran the place. And yeah. I go, hey, Neil Finn's playing here next week. Can I get in? He goes, absolutely.
Amazing. Now I'm wondering, maybe for assignment for you, Simon, is to reach out to Ian Blurton and see if he can be at Christy Pitts on Sunday at 2 p.m.
I will do my best.
I want a second. Like, he was in the backyard during COVID and we had a great chat. But I want to catch up with Ian Blurton at Christy Pitts during the Toronto Maple Leafs baseball game. That's what I want. I'm just throwing it into the universe.
Into the universe. That's what Steve Jobs did all the time, right? He did that. He'd wish it and it would happen.
Well, I'm wishing it. We'll see if it happens. Steve, what happened to Steve Jobs?
Where's your picture? Don't you have like a flip chart thing? It's like, this is a picture of me and there's a picture of me being famous.
Okay, well, I'm going to put a picture of me and Ian. There is one because we took one by the tree. We're going to take one in a moment and then I'm gonna tweet that out and see what happens. Okay. And then we'll just talk about you and Manfred. For like, you know, by the way, Change Your Heart. Do you think Change Your Heart might be the most underappreciated, underrated band in Canadian music history?
I totally agree. I mean, and he's also, Ian's doing a record now, I think, with all of the members. Like, I think there's like four bass players and like everybody who played in Change Your Heart is now part of this record that he's.
Even Sean Bora?
I don't know. Maybe. That's a name I don't know.
That's a name you don't know.
Yeah.
He's at the Cameron House right now playing. Check it out.
So all these people are like joining the band, like just playing on his record that he's putting together. Yeah, it's going to be good.
See, it's stuff we could talk about at Christy Pitts. Okay. Last jam. So thank you so much for doing this. I learned so much more about you by kicking out the jams. It's your second visit, but it won't be your last. And just remember me every time Lois hit a low play in the GTA. And what else can I say? Just that if you have old electronics, like an old phone, maybe you have your old DVD player that doesn't work anymore, don't throw it in the garbage because those chemicals end up in our landfill. Go to recyclemyelectronics.ca and then you can put in your postal code and then find out where you can drop it off to be properly recycled. Okay, so now you have two assignments. You're going to go to recyclemyelectronics.ca and you're going to get Ian Blurton to Christy Pitts.
I'm writing this down as we speak.
You're writing it down? All right, let's kick out your final jam.
Oh, this I forgot. Speaking of Scientology.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Turn away. It's so good. From the sound of your own voice. It's my album of the year. Grammy. Calling no one, just a silence. A deceit around the edge. Follow the avalanche. Turn away. It's like a David Gilmour song. Yeah.
Oh, sounds great in the headphones.
Oh, yeah. This is, I play this on every PA I come to with Los Alo to hear what a PA sounds like. This is my Steely Dan.
Well, that's right. I was going to say that's what the Steely Dan's. Steely Dan songs.
Yeah.
Right.
It's the flattest sounding. But this sounds so much low end. That's how you can really gauge so much low end. The other thing about this record is
this is Beck, by the way.
It's Beck, yeah. I watch the Grammys. Very rarely watch them. I watch them one album of the year. And he was, who came up there? What's his name? Ye came up and
Kanye
said, like, he basically pulled a Taylor Swift on him. Like, he came up and said, this is bullshit, whatever. And Beck was like, no, talk. And then, so there was this weird shit kerfuffle that happened.
Okay, I do remember this. Who would have thought Kanye would do anything controversial?
Yeah, I know. You're crazy. And then, so I found out that this record, I can listen to this record if I want to go to sleep. I can listen to this record if I want to exercise. Right. I ride my bike. I used to ride my bike a lot with earbuds. And you listen to this and you get to this part and there's like three songs to go and you're just like, just such a zen, great sounding record. And I think it's a companion to, there was another record he did that has, it's very similar. And he did this whole record in his house. And everything I like about music and recording is wrapped into this album.
Love it so much. Now, on our way out here, remind everybody like where they should go. So you're saying go to like a Sunrise location to buy the Subversives DVD.
Yeah, I mean they're distributing it. I'm not saying to sit in their front rack, but you might need to go order it.
You can ask Robert Lawson where it is.
They'll probably say, well, we can get it in for you. So if y'all go to a Sunrise and say, I'd like to buy this DVD or this Blu-ray, they will order it and you can get it. Like, I think it'd be cheaper than getting it from a record from the label because they have to pay for shipping and all that good stuff.
So Subversives, the history of Lowest of the Low, and you said Apple TV.
TV,
Google, rent it there or something.
Yep, Google Play is coming soon.
Okay.
I don't think Amazon Prime does documentaries anymore. I think they've somehow gotten out of it. And then there's going to be a few different things that are hopefully going to come down the pike and other projects, and it's exciting.
And give my love to the band, Lowest of the Low. Dave Hodge once referred to them as the Toronto Mic'd House Band, so give my love. And I love your documentary.
Thank you.
Tell Elliot Lefko to get his ass over here one day. Oh, I got to shout out his brother, who is a good FOTM, Perry Lefko. So okay. I have a Lefko, just
one
a
Lefko.
Different Lefko.
Not the other Lefko.
Lefko and leaving.
Left of Lefko.
Left of the dial.
Left-leaning Lefko.
But thanks for doing this, Simon.
I appreciate, Mike. Thank you for doing this.
Don't leave without your lasagna. It's in my freezer.
I've already thought about that.
And don't eat it when it's frozen. You'll break your teeth.
Yeah, I'll tell you
and
my wave
baby. Conklin Carney.
I saw you had a Honeyman Sweet, and I'll tell you my wave baby story next time.
One of my favorite videos as a preteen was Wave Babies.
Do you think I can get it done in under a minute?
I'll do it. Yeah.
Okay. The wave baby.
A long
story.
Song.
So I was their guitar tech for one show, for Honeyman Sweet, like in the late 90s, early 2000s, and we're playing Kingston.
Okay.
And at the time, they were playing against April Wine was in town, so nobody came to the Honeymoon Suite show.
Aww.
So it was dead. And then so I was tuning guitars that I've never touched before. And I'm tuning the Wave Babies guitar because it's the one with the guitar, the tire tread on it. And there was something wrong with it. It wasn't tuning right. So I'm like, the guy, like, we're so close to the stage, like, he goes, give me the Wave Babies guitar. It's Wave Babies time. And I'm like, oh, you're going to have to do one more song because this thing's something wrong with it. So then it's like, okay, next song, Wave Babies. And I just gave him the guitar and it was so piss poor out of tune.
That's Derry who was
Derry, yeah. And then he paid me my money and I go, you must fucking hate me right now. I apologize for...
And everyone's at Miles Goodwin there in the April Wine Show.
That's right. They're all at the April Wine Show. I go, oh, you know. So it was like one of those moments of pure, like, I'm embarrassed for you, but, you know, yeah, I got over it.
Story.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had Derry and Johnny in the basement.
They've really hit a renaissance, too, with their music. It's like it's all coming around again, right?
Everything old is new again. And, you know, he's got a new girl now, so it's all good. Okay, all right.
Good tie-in.
And that brings us... You know, the original version of New Girl Now that won the award on the Q107 Homegrown Contest, it wasn't Hot Summer Nights.
Cold Winter Nights.
Cold Winter Nights.
That's right.
One of the greatest lyrical changes in the history of rock
Absolutely.
And roll.
Absolutely. It's seasonal.
And that brings us to the end of our 1,497th show. What will episode 1,500 be? You'll have to find out. You're going to find out this week, by the way. That's how fast we're cooking here. You can follow me on Twitter and Blue Sky all over the place. I'm at Toronto Mike. Hey, do you want to send people somewhere to learn more about the Simon Head universe, or where do you want to send them?
Yeah, I'm on Instagram, pictures of my bike. It's called @SimonHead666. That's all
okay.
I do.
I'll
it's not
you.
That's not hyperbolic. That's just pictures of my bike.
I do that too.
Yeah.
I put my bike somewhere and take pictures too.
There's pictures right there.
Yeah. I was thinking, I can't do the Ride to Conquer Cancer with that bike because that is a single speed bike and we got to climb the escarpment hill.
It's a onesie. They call it Heart Attack Hill now because somebody had a heart attack on it last year.
Oh my God. Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Well, like, with that bike, I'd be walking
no
up there.
No problem.
I think,
you know,
I could probably do it.
You're strong.
I got big calves. I got the biggest calves. Much love to all who made this possible. That is Great Lakes Brewery. Don't forget your fresh beer there for your son, Palma Pasta, recyclemyelectronics.ca, the Toronto Maple Leafs baseball team, get blurred into Christy Pitts, Moneris, season 6 of Yes, We Are Open. Listen to Al Greco on Toronto Mike yesterday. You get the vibe of all that. He was fantastic. And Ridley Funeral Home. Did you know this lyric coming up is about cunnilingus?
Oh, I did know that. I'm now an expert on Lowest of Low. I don't know if you know that.
I did not know that, but I just learned that.
As soon as you do a documentary, you're supposed to be an expert on that.
Well, listen, I always fade out before... Not because I care about that lyric, but it's funny. I rarely get this deep in the song anymore because I used to play the whole song. And then somebody said, you know, when I'm biking or running or whatever, maybe you just cut it. And I said, okay, I'll fade down when I finish. So I rarely get to it.
Who do you answer to, Mike?
You're right. I'm going to fucking play the whole thing twice. I'm going to play it again. See you all tomorrow. Making her Toronto Mic'd debut is singer Lori Cullen, who is married to Kurt Swinghammer. Did you know that?
I did not know that.
That's a fun fact.
I know
Lori,
that now.
Who I met at Blair Packham's house just a couple weeks ago. Blair Packham plays with David Quinton Steinberg at
a
Danforth
world, after all.
Club called The Sauce.
Your timer is counting down.
See you all then.